it's a, I mean, the more you use antibiotics, more likely that resistance will be developed. So they should be used judiciously and only when required. And you can see that the indiscriminate use today has led to a situation where there are what are called as superbugs, which are resistant to every possible antibiotic available today. And that is a big threat. So in many cases, there is no cure because antibodies don't work and people die because of this infection, similar to pre-antibiotic area.
Hi, welcome to Biotech Talks, Antimicrobial Resistance. This is what the topic of today's podcast is. Now imagine someone getting infected with some bacteria. He or she goes to doctor. Doctor then prescribes antibiotics. Okay. Imagine if those antibiotics do not work. Okay. Somehow those bacteria are resistant to have developed resistance to that antibiotic, and there is no antibiotic in the market that can cure that infection. So that is a scary situation, right? So what are the factors which are making those bacteria resistant against the antibiotics? What is antimicrobial resistance? What are the factors responsible for antimicrobial resistance? That is what we are going to get to know in this podcast. So here I am at NCMR, National Center of Microbial Resources, Pune, to meet Dr. Yogesh Shouche. He is going to tell us about the antimicrobial resistance. So it is going to be a nice podcast. So stay tuned. Thank you.
Hello sir, how are you?
Oh, I am fine, Mustafa. How are you?
I am also doing great. So the topic of today's podcast is antimicrobial resistance. So the first thing that I want to ask you, what are antibiotics and how do they work?
Okay, so as you know, the name antibiotic itself would tell you that antibiotics. So they work against living organisms, and in this particular case, we are largely talking about organisms like bacteria and fungi. So these are the chemicals that kill disease causing bacteria and fungi. And so that's why these are called as antibiotics, and typically they are used in human and animal infections where they kill disease causing bacteria and fungi. If you're talking about mode of action of antibiotics, they act in variety of ways. And for example, if you take bacteria, there are antibiotics which target all important cellular processes. Like when you talk about a living cell, there is a DNA replication, there is a cell growth, there is a transcription, there is a protein synthesis, and different antibiotics inhibit these vital processes in the cell. So there are some antibiotics which inhibit DNA replication so that the cells do not grow. There are antibiotics which inhibit transcription, and so that the cell does not grow. Some antibiotics inhibit protein synthesis, and there are the initial class of antibiotic, penicillin group of antibiotics, they inhibit synthesis of cell wall. And nowadays people are looking for some novel targets for antibiotic other than these. So people are looking for example, the antibiotic which came into the discussion recently, taxibactin, that inhibits fatty acid biosynthesis. Then in many bacteria, there is a mechanism which is called as quorum sensing. So bacteria sense their population, and only when a certain population density is present, certain activities are started. So those activities, if the cell number is low, those activities don't start. Only when they reach a specific value, the activity starts. So, and this is sensed by chemicals, which is called as quorum sensing. And in many bacteria, their capacity to cause disease, for example, a diarrhea, the toxin which is produced by, for example, Vibrio cholerae, and it causes diarrhea. that would be produced only when the cell reach a specific density. So there are now people are looking for molecules which would inhibit this mechanism. So anti-quorum sensing molecules. So there are such multiple targets for antibiotics.
So if I am having a viral infection, so should I take antibiotics to treat that?
Actually, no. Many times the doctors wrongly prescribe antibiotics when you have a viral infection. That is normally to prevent you getting any secondary infections, because once you have a viral infection, your immunity goes down and there could be some secondary infections, and these could be bacterial infection, and that's the reason doctors prescribe antibiotics. And the best example of secondary infection that I can give you is you must have heard about mucormycosis. So which was actually a kind of secondary infection after the corona infection. And not just that, even in corona, after initial viral infection, few, if not in all the cases, there were secondary infections in the lung, and antibiotics are required those cases. So normally when you have just viral fever, it is good not to take antibiotics, because such indiscriminate use of antibiotics is the one which leads to development of resistance.
Okay, so there is a quote by Dr. Tom Frieden that says, if we are using antibiotics when not needed, we may not have them when most needed. So why Dr. Tom is saying that?
See, that's very true, and it's a kind of elaboration of what I told you just some time back, that it's a, I mean, the more you use antibiotics, more likely that resistance will be developed. So they should be used judiciously and only when required. And you can see that the indiscriminate use today has led to a situation where there are what are called as superbugs, which are resistant to every possible antibiotic available today. And that is a big threat. So in many cases, there is no cure because antibodies don't work, and people die because of this infection, similar to pre-antibiotic area. So that's why if you do not use them judiciously, such situations are likely to come more and more.
So what are the other factors which are causing this antimicrobial resistance?
See, there are many factors which cause antimicrobial resistance. One is, as I said, there is indiscriminate use of antibiotics. In a country like India, it goes worse because antibiotics are available over the counter. So a half-learned person who goes to chemist shop if he gets a throat infection or stomach ache or fever, goes to chemist shop, buys antibiotics and then takes those, and obviously he is not aware of required dose and such things, so he would just buy some 2-3 tablets, have them, and when he starts feeling better, obviously the antibiotics will be stop, he will stop taking it. Same happens even for the prescribed antibiotics. Doctor prescribes you a 5-day course, but you start feeling good after 3 days, you feel, oh, antibiotics are bad, and why should I take them now that I am feeling better, and then you discontinue. So that is one reason for developing antibiotic resistance. The second resistance is use of antibiotics in animal products, in the sense that use of antibiotics in cattle and use of antibiotics in poultry, because there is no regulation so far on residual antibiotic levels in milk or residual antibiotic levels in meat. So antibiotics are given to cattle to prevent infections, antibiotics are given to poultry to prevent infections, and then residual antibiotic in these food items, when you consume them, you also take antibiotic with them and you develop resistance. So I mean the organisms develop resistance. So that is another major cause of developing antibiotic resistance. Number one, indiscriminate use. Number two, having antibiotics without prescription and not completing the dose, and then these residual antibiotics in food like poultry and meat and milk.
Okay, so talking about solutions, so there are these viruses known as bacteriophages.
Right.
They kill bacteria.
Right.
So why can't we just hire some bacteriophages to treat infection?
Yes, so a lot of people are promoting bacteriophage therapy for especially for antibiotic resistant infections, but the problem with phage therapy is that you know, the phages are specific. At times they are strain specific, so that's why it has not become so popular, because a particular phage will not work against all the strains of a given pathogen. So for example, if you are talking, take simple example of diarrhea and E. coli induced diarrhea. So the phage, which is if you want to use phage as a therapy, it will not work against all the strains that carry that cause diarrhea. So you will have to develop a strain specific phage preparation, and that is difficult. As against that, if you see the antibiotics, many antibiotics are broad spectrum, so you don't worry about just the strain, but you don't even worry about species and genus. The antibiotic in question will kill all, I mean all, they are, let us say, gram negative antibiotic, which is active against gram negative bacteria. So it will kill every gram negative bacterium. That's why the phage therapy has not become so popular, but in extreme situations where no antibiotic works, it will definitely be a useful therapy.
Okay, so there is this company, Akagon. Okay, it develops antibiotics for this resistant bacteria. But in 2019, that company went into bankrupt. And that suggests that this developing antibiotics for superbugs is not quite a good business model. So what?
It's true that pharma companies now do not have any interest in investing newer antibiotics, and there are many practical reasons for that. One reason is any drug that is for human use, the investment is tremendous. So from the discovery stage till taking it to the market, the amount of trials it has to go through is very expensive, and after investing that much money, when you finally come up with the drug, and if there is immediate resistance for that drug, then entire investment is lost. So the companies may not be able to recover all the amount that has been invested in the research. So that's the reason they are skeptical about investing in developing new antibiotics. So that's the major problem, that the amount of investment required is very huge, and eventually they may not be able to recover the money. That's the reason there are hardly any new antibiotics that are coming up, and the research the search for new antibiotics has come to a standstill.
Okay.
So that's a serious problem.
Yes.
So after so much investment in discovering new antibiotics, again it has a limited use, because it will be used only in case of infections. So as against that, if they invest the same amount of money in a anti-diabetic drug or anti-hypertensive drug, then the rewards are much more, because it is used for much wider population. Antibody use is very restricted only in infected persons, that too antibiotic resistant infections, the antibiotic will be used. So the returns are not so high. As against anti-hypertensive or anti-diabetic drug, the returns are very high, because the target population is very high. So that's the reason they would rather invest in anti-diabetic or anti-hypertensive drug than in an antibiotic.
So what are scientists doing to deal with this huge problem of antimicrobial resistance?
See, as I said the pharma companies do not have much interest in discovering new antibiotics because of the cost involved. Of course, people are trying to increase the success rate. People are trying to use novel approaches, like getting new approaches from the organisms which have not yet been cultured in the laboratory, and there has been some success in that. Taxibacterium is the example. But since the discovery rate is rather low, people are trying to look at different mechanisms by generating awareness so that the antibiotic resistance does not develop. So generating awareness about indiscriminate use of antibiotics, controlling the use of antibiotics in the sense that many major hospitals have antibiotic policy, and clinical microbiologist attached to the hospital is involved in that. So they kind of do a survey of out of the patients developing infections in that particular hospital, finding out the antibiotic resistance pattern in those infections, and then recommending which antibiotic to be used. So they then that way they control the use of broad spectrum antibiotics, new antibiotics, in such a way that those are used only in specific cases and rarely. As against that, today fortunately the scenario has also changed, in the sense that what has happened in last couple of years is that whenever there is an infection, doctors started prescribing straight away high end antibiotics, fourth generation antibiotics. So that indirectly has resulted in a situation that though there is a resistance for these antibiotics, the first generation, second generation antibiotics, there is a sensitivity. So what then the clinical microbiologist associated with the hospital does is that in a not so critical situations, they recommend use of first, second generation antibiotics to which normal infections are sensitive. So that way they regulate the use of broad spectrum fourth generation antibiotics, with the hope that if this policy is strictly followed for the next few years, then the use of broad spectrum fourth generation antibiotics is regulated, and then there is a scope to use them only in extreme conditions. So that is one major way. And then of course controlling the over the counter sale of antibiotics, regulating the antibiotics in the environment by controlling the waste disposal, controlling the waste disposal from hospitals, regulating the residual antibiotic levels in the food products. So those are the ways people are trying to address the issue.
That's all, sir. Thank you.
Thank you
for your time.
Thank you.